Okay, we're back. We're live. I'm Jay Fidell. This is ThinkTech Hawaii. We're talking about community matters this morning with Tracey Wiltgen. And she is the executive director of the Mediation Center of the Pacific. Thank you for joining us, Tracey Wiltgen. Really appreciate it.
Happy to be here, Jay. Thanks for having me.
Title of our show is about the access to judgment, access to justice program, which we just discussed with CJ Mark Rechtenwald just a few minutes ago. It's one of his most important and favorite programs. Yeah. And you're having a ceremony coming soon where you're going to give awards to people who've been involved in the program. So let's get a handle on what the program does, what the awards are like, what the ceremony's like. Let's start with, what is access to judgment in Hawaii?
Access to justice is providing the legal resources for people in the low-income population who can't afford it. Everybody is entitled to have representation and to be able to navigate a very confusing legal system, particularly for people who aren't accustomed to being in the legal system. And so many, many people have a challenging time accessing justice. And for that reason, the Access to Justice Commission, the Hawaii Access to Justice Commission, was created a little more than 10 years ago. It's going on 11 years. And it's thanks to the dedication of many people who volunteered thousands of hours and the leadership of Chief Justice Mark Rechtenwald that it's grown and made a huge difference. And so each year, we have a pro bono celebration that you referred to, and the purpose of the celebration is to recognize all of the people and the many lawyers who've dedicated hours donating their time to assist people in the low income population so that they do have access to justice.
So how do you provide, first, how do you determine who an appropriate beneficiary is? I mean, who is somebody that this program Access to Justice wants to target as a beneficiary? Where is he or she? What's the demographic?
So the demographic is there's many, many people. It's people who are indigent or in the very low income population. And in Hawaii, that's a large number of people, probably even more so now, since many people are without jobs or have been furloughed. And the key areas, Jay, where access to justice is needed most is in the domestic arena. So couples getting divorced who don't understand the law and how a judge might divide property or what they need to do. Unmarried couples with children who they're not going to be a couple, but they still need to work out time sharing arrangements and focus on the needs of their kids. Landlord-tenant is a big area. Tenants oftentimes have no idea what their rights are under the law. And this is a really big issue in particular right now. So these are areas, and even in small claims, consumer merchant cases. So these are the areas of greatest need for people in the low income population, people who English is not their primary language. Immigrants who've come over, they're trying to work hard to earn a living and they don't understand our laws. These are the people who are served by legal aid, volunteer legal services, and the many civil legal service providers who are involved in this work.
You know, I know it wouldn't apply in every case, but at least it seems to me that in some cases, the judge can handle this. The people come before him, he can see that they're, you know, not experienced, they don't have a lot of contact with the law, they don't know what to do, so he can talk to them. Why doesn't that happen? And the family court judges do that, don't they? They sort of give special consideration to people who are ignorant of the law.
Sure, they can talk to people, and family court judges do, and the district court judges do as well. But it's important to remember that the judge can't provide legal advice and take sides and advocate for somebody, even though they recognize that this person may not have the information that they need. Judges refer these individuals out to the resources that they need to help them navigate the system. So certainly judges encourage people to go out and get the information. And that's why a lot of cases are actually referred to mediation as well.
Let's talk about mediation. You're the Mediation Center of the Pacific. Mediation is a very kindly, altruistic word. It bespeaks of let us reason together, the most noble, the highest way of human engagement. We have a dispute, let us reason together. We'll put our dispute aside and find a solution that works for everybody. It's a wonderful notion. I don't know if it works all the time, but it's a wonderful aspiration anyway. Tell us about the Mediation Center of the Pacific.
So, and I loved how you described it, and you're right, it doesn't always work. But let me tell you, the Mediation Center of the Pacific is a nonprofit organization. So we're one of the civil legal service providers who provide affordable and accessible mediation and dispute resolution services. So mediation has really grown. And so people with financial resources can select a mediator and pay, you know, a per hour fee. At the Mediation Center of the Pacific, our services are affordable and accessible to everyone. So through mediation, we bring people together at a time that's mutually agreeable, and working with an impartial mediator who helps them listen to each other in a way they haven't been able to, and helps them negotiate agreements that work for them. Now, what's important in access to justice and mediation, Jay, is that number one, we encourage people to go out and get the information they need. So we work closely with volunteer legal services, legal aid, domestic violence action center. We're encouraging people to access these resources so they're informed when they're negotiating, since we don't give legal advice. It's a much more relaxed setting. And what's really important is that the people in the mediation make their own decisions. The mediator doesn't decide for them. So if they're able to reach an agreement, we help them put it into writing. But if they don't reach an agreement, then they can go that next step and go back to court. And even if they don't reach an agreement, because you're right, it doesn't work in every situation, what we hear from people and also judges who hear the cases is that the people are more focused. They have a better understanding of what they need, how to present their case. So mediation is invaluable when people reach agreements, but it can also help people be more focused on how to move forward and be realistic about what it is they're trying to achieve.
Permit me a digression. Sure. What makes a good mediator? Not everybody in the world is a good mediator. There are human qualities. What are they?
Absolutely. So a good mediator, first and foremost, you have to be a great listener. Now that may seem silly that everybody listens, but most people don't listen carefully. Mediators are trained to listen very deeply, to understand what's really driving people. And when you are in a conflict and you're upset, most of us don't know what's driving us. And mediators listen very carefully to hear what's really driving people, to bring that out, and to help people listen to each other. Mediators also are extremely patient, to know when they can move people, when people are ready for negotiation, or when they still need to be heard a little bit longer. Mediators need to be very flexible, and they need to be effective in helping people negotiate their own solutions. And I think this is really key, Jay. So mediation is a process. I can teach you a process, I can teach you the skills, but the art is helping people come up with their own ideas and resolve it themselves. That's when people walk away feeling really satisfied. Yeah.
You've answered my second question, which was, Tracey, how does a mediator resolve disputes? You've answered that. So it's part of being a mediator to resolve Absolutely. Disputes. Yeah. So here we are. We have these various organizations that are interested in access to justice. They go out into the community. They have people. They have staffs. But you have certain pro bono volunteers who participate in that. Who are they? Are they all lawyers, or are they someone else too? And exactly what do these volunteers do to breathe life into access to justice?
That's a great question. And depending on what organization it is, they can be attorneys, but many of them, so for the Mediation Center of the Pacific and the other community mediation centers across the state, We our volunteers come from a broad background, not just lawyers. But let me go back. So legal aid and volunteer legal services have pro bono attorneys. So they're attorneys who are donating their time to help represent clients, to provide workshops and trainings. So for example, volunteer legal services has regular workshops for divorcing couples to help them understand the paperwork, to help them understand the laws that govern the divorce arena. These attorneys who are conducting these workshops are volunteering their time. They also have attorneys who represent clients at no cost to the client, as does legal aid. With the Mediation Center of the Pacific and other mediation centers, we have attorneys, but we also have non-attorneys who are mediators, and they volunteer thousands of hours throughout the year. And trust me, without the people who volunteer for all our organizations, we wouldn't be able to serve the thousands of people that we do each year, making a big difference in our community.
Yeah, why do they do that?
Why do they do that? You know, I'm going to speak from my experience, but later I know before the pro bono celebration, you're going to have some of these volunteers on your show. You can ask them yourself. But what I hear from them is they want to give back to the community. They believe in increasing access to justice, and they believe that they have a responsibility with the knowledge and the skills that they have to be able to make this difference and give back. For those of us who are fortunate, we have full-time jobs. We've been fortunate to go to school and have academic degrees and have this knowledge. It's important to share that. And volunteers also say that in addition to giving back, they learn a lot themselves. So there's a little bit of selfishness. Volunteers aren't selfish, but every time you help someone, there's definitely a reward for yourself to know that you've made a difference in someone's life.
Yeah, that's great. That kind of gratification doesn't come easy, and you have to put in to get that gratification.
Absolutely.
So now I was going to ask you, what do they do? Do they go to court? Is anything and everything, or are they specialized in one function or another? Well, for example, the Legal Aid Society lawyer seems to me they're going to go to court. But what are these other organizations more along the lines of mediation or even just talking to people, and they don't necessarily go to court? So how do you deploy the talent, so to speak?
Okay, so there's a lot of different pro bono opportunities and pro bono work going on. So I've talked about mediation. We have a cadre of approximately 125 mediators who volunteer their services as mediators. Legal aid and volunteer legal services, Domestic Violence Action Center, the Disability Rights Center, the Native Hawaiian Legal Corporation, and others have attorneys who actually provide representation for clients at no cost. There's also an access to justice self-help desk at district court, as well as at family court. And those access to justice self-help desk have volunteer attorneys who are there providing legal advice at no cost for individuals accessing those courts. So at the district court, there's individual attorneys. Law firms also adopt the access to justice self-help desk at district court for a month. Attorneys from their law firm will be available to answer questions to individuals who've filed cases there and who don't know how to navigate the paperwork or have legal questions. Same thing at family court. And most of those, well, all of the ones at family court are all family law attorneys who are volunteering their time to be able to answer questions for individuals. And this is a huge, huge benefit to the community, because as I said, there's thousands of people that access the courts that are overwhelmed by it. They don't know where to go. And by having these attorneys available to answer their questions, it helps them navigate a difficult system. It helps them move forward. You also have volunteer settlement masters. This is at family court. These are family law attorneys who use some mediation skills and their subject matter expertise to help couples that it's who are really having a hard time reaching agreements, and they're just about to go to trial, so right before the motion to set. And a volunteer settlement master will work with them, if they volunteer their time, to see if they can help them negotiate agreements and settle. There's also an appellate mediation program through the Judiciary Center for Alternative Dispute Resolution. They volunteer their time as mediators, and those are at the appellate court level. So again, trying to help people resolve their issues so they don't have to fight in court, they can save money, and it's not so overwhelming. So all of these programs, they're investing hundreds of hours to make a difference. So there's a lot of different volunteer opportunities that are going on, and we continue to try and increase that. And that's why we have the pro bono celebration. So we recognize those who are volunteering their time, so they know that they're appreciated, and to encourage others to volunteer their time as well.
Well, let's talk about that. So how do I qualify for the celebration? How do I qualify to get an award at the celebration?
So we are recognizing all of the volunteer attorneys who help at the Access to Justice Self-Help Desk, both at district court and family court. We are acknowledging all the volunteers who help with the Volunteer Settlement Master Program, and all the volunteers who assist with the Appellate Mediation Program. In addition to that, each of the legal service providers, and that's Domestic Violence Action Center, the Legal Aid Society of Hawaii, Volunteer Legal Services, the Elder Law Program at the University of Hawaii, Native Hawaiian Legal Corps, and the Mediation Center of the Pacific, each organization looks at their pool of volunteers and as an organization decides who we're going to honor this year. So we each select somebody and then that person is honored. The other thing that the pro bono celebration does is several years ago, we started having an essay contest for students to encourage students to be thinking about the importance of volunteering. And we receive a couple hundred entries, and we select seven student winners who will also be recognized through the pro bono celebration.
Yeah, let's talk about that. So this is an essay contest, and it's in class. What kind of class would it be in? Would it be in English? Would it be in social studies? Where would it be in high school?
Truthfully, it can be in any class. We don't focus on the class. We get the word out to the schools. We get the word out to all the teachers. So sometimes it could be an English class. Sometimes it could be a political science class. It varies. Sometimes students take the initiative themselves. We do provide an award. We have very generous law firms who donate $600 award, so the students receive a $500 award, and the teacher who assists that student receives a $100 award.
What a great idea.
Yeah, it's wonderful. And the essays of the students are absolutely amazing. It's really difficult.
Well, let's talk about them, Tracey. I'd like to hear some of the subjects they pick and how well they do on it.
Well, we have a theme. So each year we provide a theme. And usually it's around, you know, what inspires you to volunteer? How do you encourage other people to volunteer? This year's theme focuses on volunteering while keeping social distancing, which is a bigger challenge. So their essays are going to be very interesting. And the students will tell us stories, how they've encouraged other students to volunteer. They share their personal stories about how they volunteered, everything from helping in nursing homes to beach cleanups to helping another student learn English. And their stories vary broadly, and they're very heartwarming and compelling, and it helps you know, it reminds you that there's a lot of good things going on with our youth who are the next leaders.
Well, let's talk about that too. Gee, the way you answer my questions, you know, shows how good a listener you are.
Well, I hope so, since I'm a mediator.
I figured that. So these kids, this generation of kids, let's say the kids in high school right now, the kids who would write these essays right now, and presumably some of them get awards and come down to your ceremony, your virtual ceremony, as the case may be.
It will be virtual this year.
So did they tell you that, I mean, does this bespeak of a generation of volunteerism? I mean, I like to think, and I may be wrong, but I like to think that Hawaii has a certain special sauce about volunteering, that people are so empathetic and sympathetic. They care about the community, they care about their fellow human being. And we have more caring than most places. Therefore we have more volunteer. Am I right about that, or am I just dreaming on that point?
Fortunately, you're not dreaming. You're absolutely right. And that's part of why we're so fortunate to live in Hawaii. And the students are amazing. And a lot of it comes from the schools they attend. A lot of the schools have volunteer opportunities, encourage them to do volunteer services. A lot of the students have been inspired by their own family members who volunteer. And so you're absolutely right. It's part of our culture. Even people, when they don't have much, they're still willing to give. And that is something that's very special about the people who live in Hawaii. Yeah.
We have to hold on to that. Absolutely. And this program with the essays, that is a way to hold on to it, to nurture that thought and to encourage them not only to observe it, but be part of it, you know?
Absolutely, yeah.
So let's talk about the program itself. There's a ceremony, and in other times, the ceremony would be physical. Everybody would be in the same ballroom, what have you, but not this year for obvious reasons. How are you going to organize this? I guess it's in October. How are you going to organize it?
Correct. So we've been doing a lot of thinking about this. Generally, it's held at the Supreme Court with the Supreme Court justices, Chief Justice Rechtenwald, and 150 people filling the room. And unfortunately, we won't be able to do that, but we really wanted to still hold this celebration because of the importance of volunteerism and to continue to encourage people and youth to volunteer. So as we thought through, how do we highlight this important program and the work that these volunteers are doing? We decided through media. And so fortunately, to wonderful people like you who will give us the opportunity to be on ThinkTech to highlight some of our volunteers in October, to have Chief Justice Rechtenwald and the head of the Hawaii State Bar Association be presenting via ThinkTech. So lots of people will be able to still enjoy that celebration. We're also looking at different articles to highlight the volunteers and the students. There'll be a bigger spread in the Hawaii State Bar Association Journal. We're reaching out to other print media, and hopefully they'll be willing to give us a couple pages as well.
Yeah, P.S., by the way, we do have a website. We have various blogs on the website, links to blogs, and we would be delighted to post some of those essays as you see fit. And
wonderful.
So people could find them there and take a look at them and understand more about what these kids are thinking and doing.
That's
so, right. So now you've given awards to what? All the pro bono people. I mean, it's organization by organization, specialty by specialty. They come and get awards. Sometimes law firms give money. But you still have to have a staff, don't you? You still have a commission, right? Access to Judgment Commission, Foundation, whatever it is. How are you funding these activities?
So the Access to Justice Commission is strictly a volunteer commission. So everybody on it is volunteering their time, and they're very dedicated. And there's multiple subcommittees that meet when the commission isn't meeting, doing hundreds of hours of work. I have to say, Jay, you know, I'm not part of the commission, but I'm on some of the committees. And over the years, the level of work and the commitment and the progress that's been made has been impressive. So it's completely volunteer. How do we do the pro bono celebration? It's again, people donating money. So law firms donate the awards for the students. And the Hawaii Justice Foundation, the Hawaii Bar Association, and the Hawaii Bar Foundation have provided funding that has enabled us. Originally, we would fly students over. We won't be doing that now, but it'll help us with some of the media exposure that we want to get. So we've been very fortunate that it's strictly donations, grants, and a lot of volunteer time.
You know, this is something we talked about with the CJ just last hour, and that is the need to have the public confident of the system. Yeah. And I mean more than just judicial things. I mean the legislature, I mean the courts in general, I mean the executive branch and all the departments. But you know, it strikes me in the and we talked about this, in the time of COVID, it becomes all the more important to have the public confident of the system. You talked about people who are, you know, in the headlights when they go to court. They don't know what to do, and they're afraid. They're afraid for what might happen. They're afraid for, you know, somehow being injured in the process one way or the other. And if anybody questions that, let them go one day. I don't know if this is open right now, but let them go to the district court and hang around and see all the people. A lot of them are terrified. Or the family court, for that matter. A lot of them are terrified, and so what you provide is comfort, and you get them confident. You build confidence in the system. It's very important. But in the time of COVID, it's even more important because our whole society is being challenged. Our whole society is potentially being undermined. As we speak, by the disease and by the social impact of the disease and the economic impact, of course. So how does that work? Do you see that already happening, Tracey? Do you see the confidence is being questioned? Do you see that the system is being questioned? And do you see that these programs, particularly the pro bono programs, are helping?
Well, they absolutely are helping. And I hesitate and I have to think about my response because this is a time where people are in complete overwhelm. They're fearful more than ever. It was already scary to go to court and be involved in a legal transaction. But with COVID and people being stuck together in their homes and being angry with each other and being fearful because nobody knows what the future holds. It's created even more stress and fear for people. So even, for example, when I have somebody come to the Mediation Center, they're angrier. They're more likely to disagree with things. They're frustrated that they can't just go to court and have their case heard. So I think it's a multitude of things going on right now. And are all these volunteer services helping? Absolutely. All of our services are needed more than ever. I know for the Mediation Center of the Pacific and the other community mediation centers across the state, we have an increase in cases. And we're doing a lot remotely, and that's not always accessible to everyone. We've tried to do limited in-person while still keeping people safe. We've tried to help people navigate technology. So it's a difficult time. And so everyone's services, legal aid, domestic violence action center, all have seen an increase in need, and everybody's working hard to try and meet those needs.
Hmm. Yeah. So lawyer or non-lawyer, if I feel that I want to contribute pro bono time, or for that matter, money, where do I go? What do I do? Who do I talk to?
So you can go to the Access to Justice Commission's website, and they list all of the different legal service providers on there. So it gives you the opportunity to look at which organization seems to meet your interests, maybe meet your skill set if you want to volunteer. And all of them certainly would benefit from financial donations. So I would encourage people to go to each organization's website to see the work that they're doing, give the organization a call, talk to their executive directors so that they can meet their priorities and where they'd like to fit their skills or financial resources with each organization's mission.
Well, Tracey, you know, as you mentioned, we here at ThinkTech, we want to support the program, and we will do interviews of the winners, the awardees, and the actual virtual ceremony too. And I look forward to that. We're out of time, and I want to ask you one last question. You know,
sure.
What would you leave as a message with our viewers? What would you want them to think about? What would you want them to take away from this discussion?
I think what I want people to know is the importance of volunteering, the impact that all of these volunteers are making on our community, and that they're committed and they want to see our community be stronger. And if you have the capability of volunteering for one of these organizations or anywhere, there's a lot of different organizations that need volunteers right now, to pick up the phone or send an email and volunteer your time, because it's working together that's going to help us all move through the difficult times that we're in and make a stronger Hawaii in the future.
Yeah. Well put. Tracey Wiltgen, Mediation Center of the Pacific and Access to Justice. Thank you so much for appearing on ThinkTech.
Thank you, Jay. I appreciate it.
Aloha.